we wanted to run this session really because actually I think a few of us don't think that freedom of information requests are used enough by researchers. So part of the reason we wanted to organise this event was to be practically as well as publicly focused, to think about how we encourage researchers to use freedom of information, and also to kind of have an expert handle on how freedom of information is used and what the limitations are. I'm actually going to introduce some issues around freedom of information, because my task is to kind of, first of all, do the boring bit, but secondly, I wanted to run through one of the handouts that you have in front of you, or if you don't worry, because they're at the back, kind of really just summarises what we can't access, or the restrictions that are in place. Now, I want to kind of be a bit careful with the way I say that, because I think there's a very, very high level of discretion in the Freedom of Information Act. And in my experience, different public authorities apply the Act very, very differently. So I think, and I'll end on a point I think is crucial in the Act, which opens things up a bit. But in order to kind of think about this, I want to just maybe close things down a little bit first, so we don't get too carried away with how we think about with how the process. Look, I mean, the first issue I want to raise is that I know you didn't come here to hear me specifically talk about my research, but I'm interested primarily in corporate power. And most of my research looks at private corporations, and of course the Act applies only to public bodies. So, from the outset, we have to understand what the Act means by public bodies, and the definition has changed slightly over the years. But essentially, we're talking about public authorities or publicly owned companies, companies that are wholly owned either by the Crown or by a public authority or government department. Now, as a kind of footnote to this, I think it's really important to note that this isn't the case everywhere. South Africa is always regarded as being a kind of model for understanding how private companies, large corporations, might be accessed through freedom of information. And actually, if we look, it's embedded in the South African Constitution that everyone has the right to access to any information that's held by another person and is required for the exercise or protection of any rights, which essentially opens up access to information in South Africa. And theoretically, at least on a much wider scale. And I think increasingly, so for example, two recent public accounts committees have noted that this should be the case in certain aspects in the United Kingdom, particularly companies that are conducting large contracts in activities that would normally be public sector activities, so security and so forth. That debate is on the agenda. Nick Clegg has actually made a couple of statements in terms of. I'm not inviting you here to think that anything like says we'll bind past the next election, there are political issues at stake. But it's on the agenda. Nick Clegg has pointed out on a couple of occasions that the Freedom of Information Act could be opened up to more to the private sector side of things. So that's the first issue which I think we need to recognise as a kind of restriction here. The second issue, which I think some of our speakers will talk about, is the issue of charging and fees. And large requests tend to be refused on, and can be refused under the Act on the basis of fees. At the moment, I think, and I'm kind of aware that I might be updated on this, I think that kind of the ballpark or the rule of thumb figure is around £600 for central government, £450 for other public authorities. And that's not an uncommon refusal to get. I know that in my own experience. And it depends on the authority. Typically, regulatory agencies, if they need to spend more than 2.5 days, will take them over the £600. So that's something to kind of bear in mind. One of the most contested issues, and things are changing all the time, there was a recent tribunal decision which changed the issue of vexatious or repeated requests. So there was a tribunal decision just I think in November which extended what could be termed as vexatious requests. It's a word that you don't hear in many other contexts, but it's in the Act. In terms of thinking about the extent to which there may be repeated requests or requests which come from one particular individual, which may be for purposes that are not in tune with the spirit of the Act, could be defined as vexatious or repeated requests. Actually, the most widely known of those are the so-called zombie requests. I don't think anyone's come across this. But requests to public authorities, which have been fairly frequent in the last couple of years, about probably following the range of the zombie movies, the zombie genre which has appeared on TV screens, about how prepared public authorities are for zombie attacks. And obviously this is kind of, I'm being quite a little bit facetious here, but the issue of zombie attacks, I'm not expecting Graham to say anything, I'm sure he's aware of this, but the recent tribunal decision was trailed with a series of newspaper stories which said, well, maybe that's the end, because of the widening of the definition of vexatious, it's the end to zombie requests. And one of those requests came from the Ministry of Defence had to respond to a zombie request in 2002. I'm going to read, just to line with it, I'm going to read the quote from the Ministry of Defence. In the event of an apocalyptic incident, brackets, e.g. zombies, this is the Ministry of Defence, any plans to rebuild and return England to its pre-attack glory would be led by the Cabinet Office. So, we can be honest. And thus, any pre-planning activity would also take place there. The Ministry of Defence's role in any such event would be to provide military support to the civil authorities, not take the lead. That would be the Cabinet. Consequently, the Ministry of Defence holds no information. Unfortunately, I requested the Cabinet Office for information on the matter of zombie appearance would probably be refused on the basis that it is a vexatious request, I would guess. So listen, I've listed the exemptions under the Freedom of Information Act for you to kind of have a look at. There are some very broad, and I think some really, for me, quite worrying to those exemptions, which give authorities actually quite a wide remit, quite a high degree of discretion. So for example, on the economy, which to me strikes, I mean, and I know from following other aspects of government policy, that increasingly, for example, environmental inspectors, environment agency inspectors, food inspectors, health and safety inspectors, have to now consider enforcement action on the basis of the economic impact. Actually, this is a principle that's being increasingly embedded in government, which I think takes us in quite a worrying direction. It's in the Freedom of Information Act. Information that would or would be likely to prejudice the economic interests of the United Kingdom or any part of the United Kingdom or the financial interests of any administration in the United Kingdom would be exempt. And of course, that, I think that has ramifications for the kind of issues around also information governments might hold about private companies. Just to be kind of, I'm not going to kind of go on about this too long, but there's also exemptions in terms of communication with the royal family, which incidentally have been tightened up by this government. But information is exempt if it relates to communications with the sovereign, communications with the heir to, or the person who is for the time being second in line of succession to the throne, communications with the person who is subsequently acceding to the throne, or become heir to, or second in line to the throne. And then finally, communications with other members of the royal family. So, that's a fairly kind of blanket exemption. I'm not going to highlight the debates, although clearly there have been major debates in that regard. But the royal family, in terms of, for the purposes of the Act, were defined as a private, as being in the private sphere of it. So, I suppose I've kind of raised a number of very kind of selective issues, but you have the handout in front of you. I do want to stress that I think it's really important to take that information and know not only that there is discretion within the Act, the public authorities deal with the Act in different ways, but also the last thing on that handout, I think, is a really important message for us to maybe start off the discussion today. And that is, for me, maybe one of the most under-recognised important aspects, features of the Act, is the duty to provide advice and assistance. And that duty to provide advice and assistance means that you can approach your contact and ask if a request might be vexatious, if it might be regarded as an exemption. And you can then seek advice about how you might shape that. Of course, there's all sorts of debates about whether the advice you're seeking is vexatious, but I'm not going to get into that. But I think this is a really important aspect of the Act that we maybe start off with after I've given an overview of some of the limitations. It really does open things up in terms of our communication with public authorities, and really that's a kind of message I really wanted to reinforce that I'm sure we'll come back to. Harmit, are you going, I think you'll put on some reflections and comments on your experiences.
Well, thank you very much
indeed.
I'd like to talk very generally about my use of the Freedom of Information Act. I work at the Institute of Race Relations, and I've been doing the last couple of years a lot of research around deaths in custody. So obviously I've been making a lot of requests around that area. And one of the first things I'd say is actually no subject. So obviously I'm looking at deaths in police custody and prison custody, but I will always read independent monitoring board reports. They're all publicly available. Majesty's Independent Inspectorate reports of prisons, I will always read those, and IPCC reports, because you actually get very interesting little nuggets of information from these reports, which I then echo on. So recently, there was an independent monitoring board report into Harmit's Worth and Medical Centre, and there was one line in there that mentioned that someone had died in hospital, but I hadn't come across this death. So then I made echo on request to the PPO, ask details about this thing while they had investigated it. It produced a name and a bit of information, and I was then able to take that information and follow it up. And also, again, in terms of the deaths, I also make a point of reading the coroner's Rule 43 reports. Again, they're very useful, they contain very useful bits of information which I've then been able to refer on. So, in terms of following the death of June Mbenga, coroner last year produced a very critical Rule 43 report, and in there it contained various bits of information about how the Home Office had initiated earlier reviews into deportation policies, which had come before June's death. And then I was able to establish through FOR requests that his death actually could have been prevented because earlier investigations had been done into restraint methods being used. So, yeah. That is one of the main points I would say, is know your subject, know what information departments collect. So another example in relation to deaths in custody is, I know that the prison service would collect all information on a person who dies, their name, their age, the location of the prison, inquest verdicts, and causes of death. So you make a request, ask for that information, because you know full well that they collect it. And the same goes for the various departments. Be aware of what information they do have and they do collect, because it's very easy to make those requests. They cannot refuse those if you know that they collect that information. And also, what I would say is actually quite easy to do, is to go through the FOI logs of all different departments. So each, in terms of the main departments I would interact with, it's the Ministry of Justice, Home Office, and the UK Border Agency. And on their website, they will have a page where they will have a very large document with all FOI requests made over the last 6 months. It's well worth going through that material, because you do actually pick up really interesting stuff that you've requested for. And in relation to that, the website, what do they know? I think it's, again, it's very useful, because you can look at requests made by various individuals to departments. And it is actually interesting to see who's collecting what information and what requests are being made. So I would always say make use of existing sources of information that are already there. Also, I you have any connections to an MP, maybe use your local MP or a Lord. I have made FOI requests, again, in relation to deaths in custody, and it's quite interesting to see just the quality of information that was sent to me and the quality of information that was sent to the Lord. So I made about, a couple of years ago, I made a request about deaths in prisons. The information that was sent to me was reduced down in size, very small table, it's on A4 paper, whereas I got Lord to make the same request. He had it sent very nicely, very nicely produced A4 paper. But I think it's quite obvious what they kind of tried to do, depending on who's making the information request. And I'm sure she will speak to this a bit later, but being persistent, another area that I've made a lot of requests with, but actually not got very far, is in relation to contracts around immigration and legal centres. And I know she has made very similar requests, done them over a number of years, never got anywhere on grounds of commercial confidentiality. But as a result, people like me and Shiar and others making those requests about government contracts and private companies, the government set up the contract money database. It is a quite hard database to go through and find what you're looking for, but there is information there. If you're consistent, you can.
Police officers are aging, retired, police officers prone to war stories. I can't tell them when war stories are people related to friends or relatives about freedom of information. However, as Deputy Chief Constable, one of my responsibilities was as seeking information from the local. Anything went wrong with our information and good use and bad use of it was my fault. Within that, freedom of information was one of the areas of responsibility. So what I'm trying to do now is put my head on as a PhD student, how would I use freedom of information, and how would I use from inside to get the information I want. But I think the first thing I'd say is use of freedom of information and that legislation appropriate way to go forward anyway. It's certainly not the first step I'd take. I would look for who's the expert in the organisation I'm exploring, the senior person who's got responsibility for it, and make a direct request to them and seek a discussion with them first. Because what you won't get from them by the request is lots of questions. You might be lucky, you're unlikely to. And if you do get the context, it's then likely to be defensive. So I'll be trying to find who's the expert, and they may well provide you with information that you wouldn't get from them on my request, and you may well get it much more quickly as well. As soon as you start using legislation, you invoke bureaucracy. And if it looks at all contentious, you've gone through FOI, lawyers that get involved, experts that get involved, and I'll be talking about reasons as to why I can't give you the information. I'll give a few reasons why I should as well. I'd say, identify that person, have a conversation. You may, and there might be factors, and that might be a good way to be. However, it may often be the right way to use it. But again, look for context first, make that direct contact with somebody in the organisation. If in doubt, go to freedom of information team and public authorities can have one. Speak to them. Try and clarify the question before you pose it. Because if you ask a silly question, you'll get a very silly answer. They're not going to go out of the way to help you. They're going to be really busy. Austerity is hit free of information things as well. There will be less people doing this work. So if you ask a stupid question, you'll dismiss it. So get the question right. As you said, research it first, and then we'll talk to you. You've already been referred to, but also save you time. Look at the publications. Each of the websites. The public authorities have publications to be on. Most questions that are asked, and largely asked in journalists in my experience, will already be answered and they'll be on the site and they'll often be updated. So people are always asking about my expenses. Do I have about 10 years worth of my expenses? That would be quite near. Boring as hell, I don't know which show. Most way cafes and snow attack. But it was all there. So all you get is a terse reply saying, check. information is probably there anyway. I also say that today, no, requirements are very good. So, and will certainly not to identify who you need to contact from your organisation and who the expertise and safety provides in. Phishing tricks can work, but I suggest they need to be intelligent to their otherwise going to waste all time and others. If I gave you an example of a good phishing trick from a journalist, following the 2011 riots, there was clear tension between the Association of Chief Police Officers and Ministers. And a student journalist put out a clear phishing expedition. Can I have copies of any email between ACCO officers and the President of ACCO, or between ACCO officers and ministers? And he got some entertaining answers, because there was some really terse emails by 7 months. ACCO officers, to agree to. So, it can be worthwhile. You could waste more thought on phishing trips. FOI teams are not psychic, so the question's got to be specific, coherent and intelligent. I know it's something obvious, but huge rafts of stuff we want to be gibberish, which means they bring them back, try and clarify the question, slow everything down, and it makes you unpopular. And whilst there's not as much discretion on it, possibly though it says there is some discretion about how helpful it might be, and certainly how quick it can be. So try to make it easy. The broader your request, the less likely you are to get a coherent sensible answer as well. So make it tight. You can't do kind of random approach either. Each authority that you want information on the approach and quite the same question for all matters of approach. I would consider asking for a schedule of documents as well, about the whole area you're looking at, and then try narrowing it down. Always remember it, you're not entitled to the document when trying to put some information. Doesn't mean you're going to get the document, but they should come up with a schedule of documents. So if you're interested in having all the police and all the police certificate, you could ask a question about internal policy documents on the police and stuff of the program. They can always send you all the titles. They might not send you anything that's in it, but you should at least have some of it you can then explore further. Well, the panel issue is important. Make it specific so that they can do it in a day or two. Otherwise, you might never realize that you're going to have information that's too expensive unless you want to pay for it. So, but a way around that, if you're more sensible than reasonable and it's not vexatious, is an iterative approach, asking multiple reasonable questions to get the information that you want. That's perfectly legitimate and can be done. So, you're actually making thousands of pounds worth of requests to put in. But each of those questions is one of its own rights. I take that approach. It might be irritating eventually, but if they see there's a reason, it should get you information you want. Learn and use the terminology that the organisation uses. Do not use any of the jargon, don't use your own jargon, don't use slang. So to be facetious, if you're interested in public order policing and you put in a request for freedom of information, asking any instances of kettling, documentation and kettling. Bear in mind, freedom of information to you member is not going to be a public order requirement. You might just as well get an answer about teapots. Police talk about containment, they don't talk about kettling. So you learn the language, because you will get some answers. I'll probably enjoy sending them as well. That's with the sounding request, the behavior plan action, which also will be enjoy drafting that. Be clear about who you are. They're going to Google you anyway. Do open source check and find out who you are. We always did. open source checks. We want to know your motivation for it. Now, if you're an academic, you're asking, they're very much more likely to bend over backwards to help you than if you work for the daily mail. So, say who you are. Why you're doing it, and you may then even get much more context. You might be off to a meeting to help explain something. Please, when you do the freedom of information, remember they may not make the decision matter. In contentious cases, I make the decisions myself. Good advice, provide the decision. So you may not be talking with a
Subject to the right of appeal to a jury. tribunal, and then you get into the court system on the court's door. But it is seen as a fairly kind of swift and effective remedy, and with of the equivalent bodies in other jurisdictions internationally, we've got some strongest powers of the international wage unions. So that's what we do. Just going back a bit to some of the broad issues, and then I'll just quickly pick up on some of the points that have been made so far. I mean, it's actually a relatively new right, this one. It's been with us for less than 10 years. We brought it in January 2005, alongside a sister regime which is arguably more powerful in the area that it operates in, and that's the environmental information regulations, which flow from international convention, or the Aarhus Convention, which is all around the environment, access to justice, and public participation in matters to do with the environment. If you think about it, pollution doesn't respect national and political boundaries. So this is an area which is ripe for international agreements. There's a European directive, and our law flows from that. And there are some interesting points we can might get to in discussion later, where it's actually questionable whether in some ways the UK has implemented the international obligations are compatible. So in such a case around that, which we spent some time on the Court of Appeal just last week. So that's it's a new and developing and growing area of the law. Mentions have been made of publication schemes. We always talk about sort of proactive disclosure, proactive publication of information, and that's what the publication scheme is. But you have to remember that although it's fairly recent, this legislation, it was drafted and put together with paper records in mind, and information being held in Whitehall filing systems. Whereas we all know that isn't where the medium for obtaining and sharing information. So that's why in some respects I think this legislation already looks a bit clunky, although it's fairly new. So we try and fit the provisions that we've got to the current environment of information management. So proactive publication through a formal scheme, but basically go on the website, use your search engines, and back to your portal, all these things have said. Know your subject, find out what's out there already. Because if you are trying to get information, which you think that an organisation might be a bit reluctant to give you, even if your motivations are very sound as researchers or genuinely interested in not acting on mischief, it's important to maintain your credibility as individuals that people are trying to get information from. And absolutely, of course, what reinforcement leaders says about getting that dialogue going. So if you're making a request, it would just invite people to pick a phone number and talk to you. So if you need any more clarification, or if you think you've got information that might help me, but I haven't phrased my question quite the right way, please get back in touch with me by phone or by email. And if you can get that dialogue going, then you're likely to have a much more kind of productive outcome in terms of your request for information. So that's the proactive side, but I've also touched on making a request, which is the bit about getting information out from organisations, in particular when they're reluctant to do so. The other aspect of proactive disclosure, which we're hearing a lot about at the moment, is open data, where the government is really pursuing a transparency agenda and trying to put a lot more data out there so that people can do with it what they like. And that's very interesting for entrepreneurs, app developers, and so forth. And that's good. But Francis Maud indicated in his speech years ago that he was looking forward to a time when it would be necessary to have information rules because the information would be pushed out there in the way of the open literature. I would suggest that we're not going to get there. And one of the reasons that we're never going to get there is that the open data agenda is led by government and public authorities. It's about them putting out there the information that they want to pretend they're uncomfortable with being. Very often, certainly ones that I see, freedom of information requests about trying to tease out as much information from public authorities that they're reluctant to put out there. Or even information that they don't understand that they have, that they don't know that they have it, and they don't understand the significance of it to others. Because you might see the value of information and have a particular interest in it, which the local authority, the police force, or the government department, whoever it is, doesn't see a need for. They don't have a business need to use that information in that particular way. So FOI requests, I think, hopefully will always be with us. I say, apart from the environmental information regulations, it's domestic law, so technically, Parliament could repeal the Act. I think it's going to be quite hard for any politician to say transparency is a bad thing publicly, but frankly, we know privately that an awful lot of them, especially those who have been bitten by FOI, would rather that the Act was repealed. I think if itself is able to be done secretly, I fear that there would be quite a lot of people who would be yes vote in secret. But that's another issue. Just a couple of points, but I hope we'll get into some discussion. On this business of vexatious requests, there was this case last year, and we revised our guidance during the summer to take account of it. I've got very mixed views about things like requests for zombie towns, because they get the laughs, but the trouble is that things like that bring a serious regime into disrepute, and they enable the opponents, the political opponents of the freedom of information regime, to say, look how silly it is, look at what public servants are having to waste their time and their money on in terms of dealing with these data FOI requests when they should be putting them to frontline services at a time of austerity. And that's quite a tricky argument to have. So when I think it was the Local Government Association a few years ago, Christmas time, to get, you know, there wasn't any news, they put out something, I can't remember if it was the Daily Mail or whatever it was called, but it was the 20 most stupid FOI requests. And I know that was basically designed to do an FOI to motivate the FOI moment. So it's a serious one, I think, to be taken seriously. I think that's pretty much. Oh, the point about how data is collected differently. I think that's right, and it is good if you can kind of tune into how the organisation is dealing with work. But you can actually get some quite interesting sort of cases we've done as well. Outcomes for no obviously good reason, and so that is something that you can get some interesting outcomes from. And then just finally, and please don't leave anything to my personal politics about this, but interesting, what was the way that the exception on information about what the funding was tied up was actually done by the previous government and not the current government. And it's the sort of thing that all suddenly kind of fancy to get along, because when you're in power, things look very different. I'll leave it there.
And we will talk about the infamous page in Willis' autobiography, because his things were British.
He takes up far too much of my life.
Okay, going on. Graham, thanks, that's very useful. You've opened up a thing. And the last one, of course, I want to pick up on the whole of the people who will pick up on the country. Shiar.
Okay. But it's also an act that full of injunctions. first example is a few years ago, before the government started to publish contracts and calls with private contractors on that version of the contract. So I submitted an inquiry request to the UK Border Agency at the time, or whatever it was called, a few years ago, about the values of the contracts it holds with the private landlords who provide all the asylum accommodation in the UK. Because at the time there were 8 or 9 companies that provide all the asylum accommodation, now it's a few years companies. So the contracts have changed. The request was refused under section 43, which is the commercial interests, and Harmit has argued that to release this information would, would cause harm to the agency's ability to negotiate contracts, and so it's, because the exception is releasing, it's any information that may, releasing it may cause harm to the commercial interests of anybody. And that could be the private contractor or individual or public body itself. And although in theory they shouldn't take into account when, because it's a qualified exemption, so they have to do this public interest balancing test, they have to consider all the factors for and against the information. And in theory, it shouldn't take into account the private interests, it should be only public interests. But in the lines that are there between what's public and what's private. So because of public, this is one of the common arguments. It's like, by harming the commercial interests of the contractor and the agency's commercial interests in the future, negotiating contracts and things and stuff. So after I questioned the general view, didn't go anywhere, then I appealed to the Information Commissioner's office. And the Information Commissioner upheld the appeal. And so the information was released. And my argument was, there is some evidence that some of these contractors are providing substandard services. So the public have the right to know how their money, taxpayers' money is being spent and whether they're getting value for money. And that time for it. And you don't have to, in theory, the act is meant to be applicant blind, so they're not, they shouldn't consider your identity and your motivation. But in practice, just tell them, check it out. And if you do give them like some indications and why you want to, not why you're studying, but why you are arguing against it, then they will help. Also, the second example is last year we were doing some research about mass deportation flights, which is where the UK Border Agency rounds up a certain number of people from a certain nationality or country and deports them on one specially chartered flight to that country. And the program has been in place since 2001. There wasn't much information about that, about how it works, how much it costs and stuff. So we did a whole report about it, and most of the information in the report came from FBI request. I'll give you a couple of examples about how we used it, how we used the FBI acts a bit more creatively. So the first one was, which is an obvious example, is like, how much do these charter flights cost? And there is no figures about this, so we did an FOI request about the annual expenditure on the charter flight program. And then separate FOI requests about how many people were deported, and then from those figures, how many people were deported in each flight, and links in the maths we worked out how each individual was deported on a charter flight cost. And then we were able to establish one of the arguments that the Home Office have been using for introducing child flight for a decade now is that there are no cost effects. And we established through this FOI request that actually the cost of deporting in anticipation of some people getting last minute injunctions, which has happened from the High Court and so they're removed, so they don't want to mention the disease, so they go over. And then some people, if the claims will be taken back, those have got to stress unnecessary and it's potentially unlawful if it's not in court, but someone if there is a realistic prospect of removal. So anyway, and obviously if you submit an FOI request to the Home Office saying, are you overlooking flight? It's unlikely to be answered in a positive way. So we I submit an FOI request about the passenger capacity of the aircraft they used for these flights, certain flights. And then a separate FOI request about how many people were deported to this country and then from that how many people were deported. And by comparing the figures, we established that some of those, and then how many removal directions were issued for that flight. We were able to establish that for at least 3 or 4 of them were flights, they did overbook an hour and a half minutes of that. And it goes, of course, it's evidence that we used to change the policy, and you know, you can't really deny it. This happens if someone moves the but just to give you an idea that you know using the FOI like any other research, it's not just thinking, it's important to know how the public authorities and government departments report information before you know how many refusals is people not to store this information in the way requested. They might report it on other ways. So you have to know how they think and how they work and to help them work with this information. But it's also important to think a bit out of the box, like how we need to make different pieces of information to establish the context of what is not given to you, is it not? And be a bit persistent and challenging, and you know, it takes time and a lot of time and energy, but you know, sometimes I think we're feeling the contract.
Great, Shiar, thanks. We'll come back to you maybe on that one issue about successful judicial. It's really useful. Stuart.
I understand, actually, so I can see who I'm talking to. So thanks for the invitation. It was my idea to go 6, which now on reflection is a stupid idea, because everybody's covered everything so brilliantly, but I'll do my best. And part of what I want to do is go a bit broader. Actually beyond you know, some of the issues of how to use FOI, which has been so well covered. I want to look at a couple of broader issues. One is FOI in relation to the wider transparency agenda, which has already been touched on. And the other is, again this has been touched on, but freedom of information and the changing nature of the state. And I want to make a few observations about universities and where we fit in at all. First of all, I think it's really important to realise, as researchers, that there's a much bigger agenda around openness, transparency, and so on, than just FOI. And I actually had the same phrase as Graham did in my script here about FOI being a bit of a clunky mechanism. Knowing that I was sat next to Graham, almost crossed it out, but I can't say that. So he used it first, I meant. And in many ways, it was designed years before the Act actually came into to be. And two things about it. One was the nervousness in government at the time about what they were letting themselves in for. And the other, which we've heard some stuff about that, but the other was a lack of understanding when this legislation was first drafted about what the web might mean for all of this. It's quite quaint, really, when you look at it. In recent evidence to the Justice Select Committee, which did process post-legislative scrutiny of the Act, Jack Straw, who was Home Secretary at the time, said, and I quote, "When we drafted the Freedom of Information Act, we had no serious conception about the internet, which was in its infancy." That's the turn of the century. I mean, I remember using the internet in 1999, 2000. I remember knowing vaguely what was going to happen as a result. So I don't know if that really says much about the state of the internet at the time, and what about New Labour Tony Blair famously, you know, told us all, he never sent an email or all this. I think this is really, really important because the transparency and openness agenda has been driven into completely new places over the last 10 years because of it. And the genie is not going back into the bottle. So things like publication schemes and so on, yeah, fine, great, yeah. But actually, often just use Google, it's a lot easier. Always go back to the publication scheme. And what we've got happening now is an agenda being driven for all kinds of complex political reasons, actually. An agenda around openness and transparency, which is really going in places that people never would have dreamed of in a little while. Eric Pickles, who's clearly got it in the local government as the Secretary of State responsible for the local government, has been very much driving the transparency agenda for local authorities, so that now we're going to see the routine release of information on expenditure items in local government over £500, purchase orders over £10,000, procurement contacts over £10,000, and all manner of workforce and pay data, including details of senior salaries above a certain level, who by name is paid how much, etc., etc. This information is now available for masses of local authorities. I don't think all of them yet. And a whole range of other public bodies are going to follow suit, so the finders, etc. We're going to see this information now easily available, which, you know, some of us would have dreamed of having access to that 10 years ago. So there's more and more coming. So for a lot of the research I do, I have used FOI, but a lot of it is actually this routine information which is increasingly in the public realm, which actually for researchers raises a whole host of other questions and problems. What is finding information in the first place? Yeah? It can be incredible how long you have to search for some of this, in some cases, how badly designed some of the websites are and so on. Secondly, we touched on this in relation to FOI information is supplied, the format the information is provided in on the web. Some of it's brilliant, yeah? There's an obvious case study we can do of MPs expenses about how freedom of information drove in part as well as journalism, the process of making access to that information routine. If you go on IPSA's website now, the Independent Parliamentary Standards Authority, if you want, just a few clicks of the mouse, you can find out how much money Luciana Berger MP spent on taxis last year. Yeah, I did it yesterday. £15, if you know the answer. And click, and there it is. Yeah. For all kinds of other things, you would not believe the obscure ways in which incredibly valuable information is reported. You know, just hidden in PDFs. It's not quite deep web, you know, you can find it. So if we look at things like the register of members' interests for the House of Commons or the House of Lords, it's all just put in PDF documents. And then, you know, you can go through and you can copy it all across into Excel and you have to reformat it all. You can do what The Guardian did if you're really clever, and this is going to be a really interesting area for research in the next few years. You can scrape data. I don't know how to do this. You have to write code, so you need a web person, which then automatically take all the information and turn it into a viable form, which is what The Guardian did with the register of members' interests, I think for the Commons and the Lords. And we've seen more and more use of it. So I think one area, I guess most of us are social scientists, but how we work with computer scientists to pull together this information is really there, I think, is a really interesting area. You then get into, obviously, lots of issues about cleaning up data. I mean, some of the stuff I've done around funding of political parties. The Electoral Commission registers about donors to political parties are by now fantastic in terms of searching, in terms of taking away the information in a CSV format that you can import into Excel or SPSS. Of course, you can't deal with the people who've done the deep data entry and have put in a typo or inadvertently change somebody's name or whatever. Or, indeed, the people who decide to declare their donation under the name of a family member or a company or just slightly change the way that they're worded this time compared to last time. So one of the projects I did involved going through actually collating all of the donations which were clearly from the same people. It was an enormous research task in itself. So it's another challenge. And another reason I think we've heard about that is all this information that's there, there is a lot of caution about what's put on the web routinely. So it's what you then have to do to get your name alone, which is, I think, increasingly where Athwal comes in. So that brings my second point, which is issues really around how the state is changing and what this means for FOI. We've heard some stuff about private companies and issues there, and I won't dwell on this too long. But obviously, with more and more stuff being contracted out to the private sector, often in some of the most contested and controversial areas, that issue about whether private companies providing government services should really be exempt, whether it should be as difficult as it is to get the information in the cases, I think is a big one. Which brings me on to universities. Because, of course, in universities, we're all in favour, aren't we, of transparency and openness? We're all in favour of this idea that the information should be out there for us to research. right, here's some interesting things. Charging for FOI requests. In the Select Committee report that I've talked about, they actually found at that time, it's a couple of years old now, two-thirds of local authorities never charged. Never. Two-thirds of them. Okay? Only around 5% of local authorities had charged in more than 5% of cases. So within local government, charging is actually pretty rare. Okay? Universities, they invoke the Section 12 exemption, which is around the cost and charging, in about a quarter of cases. Yeah, and we're talking about institutions involved in, obviously, the management and storage of data, etc. Part of routine, part of what we do. I'm quite shocked by that when we compare that to local government. In evidence of the Justice Select Committee about FOI, Universities UK pointed out that because funding arrangements are changing for universities, there's less coming directly from the state because of the £9,000 fees, etc. So they provided the figures about how it's, the public sector share is diminishing, with a projection that it's going to go down to about 22% of university funding will be directed from the state. And the reason they were doing this was to argue, actually, so we don't really need to be subject to FOI, do we? Yeah? Because really, the conventional definition of a public body is one who receives more than half of its funding from the state. There's also lots and lots of complaints in universities that they're handling too many FOI requests. Guess what the average is? The average university handles 10 a month. Apparently this is seriously onerous. I mean, I'm quite surprised by this, really. So I think we've got work to do within the university sector, not just as researchers, in terms of making FOI requests, but also in terms of thinking about how we make our data available. And that goes for university administrators and managers as well. And if I've got one big point today, really, which is there is always stuff that's going to be hidden away, there always will be. But we are moving very, very strongly towards openness and transparency. And universities are not going to escape it. We're being driven towards not just an open access agenda on publications, but also an open data agenda. And I'm all for it. I think it's a good thing. It may not be good. So I look forward to the discussion.
Great, Stuart, thank you very much. I wonder how many universities, if you've asked 10 a month with the number of university researchers make, that may be quite a different, an interesting cost contrast. I want to say just very briefly, kind of just to follow, because the cost debates really to me are quite incredible in the context of some of Graham's comments about the kind of undermining of the freedom of information system, probably the kind of secretly held view that this is actually quite a pernicious system. We know from research a couple of years ago in UCL, well, it's not, we don't know this precisely, but the best estimate we have is that the annual cost of freedom of information requests would affect £5 million a year. Now, if you put that in context, just before Christmas, the Beckmans got or new mansion for about 4.5 million, more than that. And you, any Liverpool fans here will just have had to look at the papers yesterday to see the debate about Luis Suarez last summer being worth 40 million in the buyout clause. So I think that puts it in context in terms of the value to us, the value to the universities and so on. I think some of Stuart's statistics in that sense do make us look quite, I'm saying us as people who work in universities, look quite shameful in terms of our employers. So on that controversial note, look, we're running over time a little bit, but I'm going to propose that we shift 15 minutes of our hour that we have in the second half to this half, so we have time for questions. But before I go to questions, I want to summarise some of the key, because I think we've had, in the range of speakers, actually an incredibly rich how-to guide in terms of using freedom of information. I want to summarise the points that the speakers made just so that we go away with that kind of very useful, almost stage by stage analysis. But before I do that, maybe we can have some questions and comments. Nobody wants to ask Ian what his expenses
are. He's still real with. Can I just make a comment, a bit of clarification about costs and benefits against your ticket? First of all, in response to that, my previous boss is an information Richard Thomas, pointed out on this 35 and whatever it is, that is across the whole public sector at Y, that is less than the annual cost which is spent on the maintenance of the Royal Parks. So
most of that is the Royal Parks, yeah, and the Thames Mansion.
This thing about charging, it's quite a difficult concept. There is no charge for making an FOI request. That's the first point. And where this £600 and £450 comes in, it's a kind of notional time cost equation based on £25 an hour. I could tell you how that's come up with that.
Sure.
I'd be sort of secret.
Okay.
But
the assumption is
it's not actual cost.
Yeah.
It's not actual cost. It's a rough figure that one person's time costs them £25 when they're dealing with that wire request. And the cost limit of £600 is only for central government bodies, so that equates to 24 hours of work for one person. And it was set at that because that was the limit for parliamentary questions when FOI came in. Because if it cost you more than that still to answer a parliamentary question, then you don't have to answer it. You couldn't, as a member of the public, have a better right to information than he would have. Setting aside what Congress quite correctly told us, I'm not surprised at all about the differential treatment that you get if you're an MP making a request for information on the board rather than a new system. For most public authorities, it's £450, which is why my police force is there for local authorities. But the point is that it's not that you're charged that amount of money for making a report, you're charged if it gets over that amount. You can be, but basically FOI requests are free. Stuart referred to the process which has gone through reviewing FOI Act. And frankly, those of us who are advocates for it, it's quite a great victory that we've come out the other side of that process. And still, there are no charges for FOI requests. Doesn't mean to say that no change needs to come at the moment, but we're okay with it. And then it's this where this advice and assistance that if somebody says that you can't do it, it costs too much to answer your request, then you've got the right to go back to them and say, they have an obligation to come to you and say, but within the cost limit, we could answer this for a lesser time period or a narrower subject or whatever. So it is very powerful.
Sure. And I mean, the same research that we referred to found that the average notional cost of a freedom of information request was less than 300, so less than the notional 12 hours.
And I think there's two or three ways of thinking about that. One is to be kind of cynical, drawing on some of the points that Stuart made, and think, well, actually, this is a resource which given the Royal Parks analogy, is underused, right? And it's a resource we can all draw on. 12 hours of someone else bringing out information from us is that we can do fairly regularly without it being vexatious, is something that is a real value to us, I think, not just in universities, but to the public that we probably don't draw on enough, despite the fact that there are those political pressures that we're doing on this alluded to. But that's really the kind of political message of today. Do more. It doesn't really cost too much. It's not onerous in terms of the public. None of us should be feeling guilty, certainly, about this. And we'll come back to some of those questions. Anyway, after that, I'll get
to just to go back to the sort of the discretionary nature of Athwal, and I just wondered if any of you had experience with Athwal. When a request was refused and then subsequently appealed, what's normally the time period? Because it obviously just says, unless a reasonable period of time has elapsed, and it's very vague. And do you think that's also linked to the nature of the request in the first place?
Do you want to respond to the next question?
I might have picked up everything on that. In terms of the appeal process, the only actual sort of time limit is 20 working days responding to the request. You then have to request a review, and that should be done within 20 working days, but that's not a statutory time table, so a lot of them, that's when it starts to time it takes out. And there's no, to be honest, it's not so bad now, but in the early days, it was just as well, but there was no time limit on the information commissioner for the length of time that he takes to make a decision on a complaint. In Scotland, under their separate regime, they've got a 4-month time limit for resolving a complaint. Doesn't usually take as long as that now to do it. It's one of the best ones. But in terms of what you do find, and this is where I think it links to the discretion thing, is that you will find that as time goes on, very often the information becomes less sensitive, in inverted commas. Sensitivity is not an exception on the FY Act, but the organisation might feel more comfortable about releasing that information. It's got less currency relevant to heat out the situation. And so you might, and that plays into getting a positive outcome. It doesn't necessarily mean that they would, or even that they should, have released the information at the time when the request was made, but it's because the passage of time is something that certainly we take into account when we're looking at the public interest test. So the longer the passage of time since the information was created, when it might have had a real currency, it might have genuinely been exempt from. The passage of time tends to mean that dwindles and any public interest it can be released. Is that?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
I don't know if you want to say anything, Shiar, because you have some experience of appealing as well.
The longest appeal I've had is the only. So between the original request and then the time review, that can be in the information commission I do. It was with the Home Office. And then I appealed to the information tribunal. That took a year, and that window is tied up because a week before the Home Office started to change their mind and respond to the problem.
A week before?
Yeah, they said 3 days. So it could take even longer. If it goes to the High Court, it will actually break up because it's not the only one who wants to move from the station. Not far from the station. And that's not the only one from the station. It's a long process, but if it's worth it.
It has to be something that you're in for the long haul, and you've got to be clear if you're setting out that it might take you a long time, and we were saying earlier. It's not, if you're looking for instant gratification, then you might have to look for it through an FOI request. The journalists who use it successfully are investigating journalists, members of all correspondents of defence, but they've got whose stories and things are interesting, they've got real longevity, and they're still going to be good stories in the years to come. News desks don't use it at all.
and one of them is sort of hoping to get off on a different theme, or the criticisms of FOI, but it comes back to the issue about thinking about whether FOI is really the best way to try and get your information. The fact that there's criticism from journalists that if an organisation wants to deflect a pertinent press inquiry, which is difficult for them, they will say, you need to put an FOI request in for that. Whereas before FOI, they would just have gone and done with it.
I wouldn't entirely agree.
Would you?
No. 70% plus of our requests were from journalists, lovely technical journalists, not serious journalists. They were backing up stories, local papers in particular, very few sources in these days. They also got round the, apparently they have ethics journalists, and they should come back to you to, if they write a story about you, they should give your organisation an opportunity to comment on it. What they would take, most of the journalists we know, we took the FOI request as that opportunity to comment, which was why I always, this is where the cost comes in, so again, there's a cost issue here. The cost for us was usually not the data. The data was available, the data was available. The cost was putting the context around the data, because we constantly got burned by journalists, not very good journalists, normally, doing stupid stories based only on that, and then never going back for clarification. So I can see very many, they always have such journalists, not very many serious journalists who get a go in on dealing with the attack of journalists, we had local journalists, a lot of local journalists, putting in FOI requests, storing stories, and coming back later, and suddenly you found something that they had never been strong. So I was quite touched about FOI and make sure, is it a journalist? The check in, is it a journalist, a freelance journalist, putting this in? If it is, I'm damn sure you've got the context for that, because they won't come back and ask us again. And if, once the damage is done to that legal authority, it's really difficult to shore it up. So it's not an unmitigated good freedom of information. It is a good review. It allows thoughtful campaign people to get at data. It does encourage defensiveness, and this is why I say often it's not the best route to go. You can get around the defensiveness if you go direct. If they don't answer, then you get four ways out.
Any other questions or points?
As you said, for example, I wasn't sure if I understood right. I think it was Stuart talking about German contracts. I wasn't clear about the status restriction. And so we have to say, an example for an exemption which applies on
contracts. And that's that they have to routinely release details of all procurement contracts over that amount. Oh. So they just have to be routinely published. And this applies to more than one of the colleagues. So, yeah, stuff that you would, in the past, you might have had to make an FOI request for it to more and more, you know, meters. Yeah.
But one of the issues that I think Shiar faced is trying to get contracts for what are normally public sector responsibilities from the public bodies or sensitive commercial information. I don't know if you want to say anything.
Well, nowadays we need to process. There is most, especially big contracts, and they've got a backlog, and the fact that they're dealing with, and they're taking more and more contracts, and there's contract funders, which is really difficult to navigate, and someone should redesign for them. But before, yeah, they the contracts, and even the values of the contracts, you might find it difficult to find if it's not in the documents. And so
wondering if anyone has had the experience of trying to get an FOI to get past data from a government department when the formulation of a government policy basically exempts information should be.
Yes.
That's really where the argument is now, because yes, if the government department says this information relates to the formulation of the policy, none of the raw information is going to be called for. So, for instance, we're dealing with a lot of complaints at the moment about the introduction of universal credit. We've had problems in several reasons about HS2. And so they immediately fall exempted there, but it's a question of the public interest. And so you get arguments of the public interest and the public knowing because they've got a right to know it's about public expenditure. And actually, if decisions aren't yet, final decisions aren't yet made, then there's an opportunity for the public to make a meaningful contribution to debate about the issue of this is a parliamentary democracy. But the counter argument from government is government needs safe space to govern, we need to be able to have our free and frank discussions. We're not performing the function of government in the goldfish bowl. And once we agree the policy, and the policy is clear and being enacted, that's the point at which so you get a lot of those sort of cases. And if you're really interested in it, and some examples, Ian kindly mentioned the ICM website. If you look at our website, which is ICM.org.uk, and go to decision notices on the FOI pages, and you can get there just from one click of the front page if you look right at the bottom of the screen print. Then go to decision notices, put into the search box the government department, or if you're interested in criminal justice, police force, criminals, whatever in there, then that will give you in most, starting with the most recent order decisions that we've made, and then include the exemptions that we've made under. You can put in the exemptions, so section 35.1a, if you want to talk about, and that will give you all the decisions that we've made on that subject, and that will give you a flavour of the sort of arguments as well as the topics.
Now, non-government departments are able to search in that way, such as DMS.
Able to?
Search in that way.
Oh, you can search anything, every public authority. Yeah.
Did you want to add anything? Sure.
The assumption behind this is the safe space argument and also the engineering effect argument, which is the civil servants should make decisions without the fear of being exposed to danger. And I just wanted to add another catch-all exemption. It's section 36, the prejudiced effective conduct of public affairs. And I have a really good about that. When the act was being debated in the House of Lords, Lord McKay, summed up the exemption sole purpose as follows. Obviously, the draft's been decided just in case something escapes and there is one last deficiency, let us get it with grenade. And it is used, and it is the exemption used for the MP's expenses for years until the end of the first.
But it is subject to the public interest, so. Some information was ordered to be released in the public interest, and that's very often what it turns out. So they, actually we're quite not just saying it's only 23 exemptions, because there's 23 sections of the Act which give exemptions, but within some of those sections there are multiple exemptions. I think the general recommendation is that it's about 45 exemptions in the Act. But most of those are subject to the public interest test, and that's really
really where you have the art.
I mean, can I just say, in terms of kind of underlining that, when my experience has been in three responses I've had, which invoke those kind of bodies, it looks like there has been an attempt to say, okay, we're going to invoke this kind of safe space for the policy development argument, and then see if you can seek the balance. And that really just reiterates the point that Graham made. To make those kind of requests, you have to be in for the long game, really, and hopefully the information commissioner will come through, or at least you can take it to try to win that.
Well, I think that's right, but again, Ian said about internal reviews and the fact that it isn't necessarily a rubber stamp by the organisation of its own decision. They are quite often genuinely reviewed independently and people take it as seriously as you can get it. A more generous outcome. The other thing actually that it does, if you're a public authority, is that it puts the public on notice that you aren't somebody who's going to go away quickly. You are here for the long haul. So don't just try and fob me off. I want an internal review, and by the way, if I'm not satisfied, I'll go into the information commissioner. And you then, and what then happens? And again, it's not necessarily about trying to avoid your obligations. It's very often hard-pressed public servants who are just trying to get something off the desk so they can get on to the next thing. But it does mean then that people will say, okay, well, we've put the effort in to try and get it right this time, because if it goes to the Information Commissioner, then that's just going to take another load of time and resource. So there are pragmatic situations. Try and put yourself into the place of the person who's handling this thing, and actually they're all human beings too.
Great. What we're going to do in the second half is we're going to have one-to-one sessions, and I'm just aware that the time might be is it the kind of question you
can
ask?
Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to second request to you to end on expectations. Section 40 in the proportionality. The size of the request to find it's going to be on trial days at the time. So are you suggesting that that could just divide into bite-sized chunks and percent that is subsequent, probably amounts to the same value, but it's only going to be with smaller requests?
I think the message is that you should try and get into a dialogue with the person who's responding to you. And to find out if it can be done in bite-sized chunks. If they say no, then it might be grounds to appeal, I guess. That's the short answer. But I think you should probably be following this up in the second half as well.
Yeah.
How you might be kind of that's your contact in that context. Yeah. Good example. Look, I'm going to draw this part to a close, but before you pack up, I do want to take seriously everything we've heard today and try, in my own way, to summarise what I see as the seven lessons that have been not handed down by Moses from the mountaintop, but that I think are very, very important lessons that we've heard today. I'm going to go through them, and of course, I hope I'm going to cover all bases. But I suppose in terms of thinking about this as a process, the first point was made by several speakers, you need to know your subject. And that's not, I don't necessarily mean the information sources which are out there, or I think it was an important point made by both Harmit and Ian, in terms of thinking about the context, knowing the context of the subject, and doing some kind of background process to know that the social issues that we are asking about, or the issues that we're asking about, can be complex and have a context. That really is about the data sources that already exist. Well, everything that Stuart said, but also that all of our speakers said, Harmit, Shiar, and Ian, in different ways, talked about in relation to what's out there already, the data forms that have already been published, and are increasingly shooting from being published. Third, I
and probably something we didn't anticipate to be talking about today, be open about who you are. Because we've heard it from, I was going to say the horse's mouth, from Ian's mouth. We're not told not to use slang, that's not in the... let's not be, we have to be precise about our language. We've heard it, that actually, and it's not absolutely not surprising, because it's what most of us do in our jobs if we get an unsolicited kind of email that we might kind of try and check if that person's going to inquire. So be open about who you are, because that's going to all come out in the wash anyway. Lesson three. Lesson four, try and make informal contact first. And I think that's a crucial lesson. You know, Ian made your point. It's also bound up with the point of a kind of 4A, the grey maze. Be respectful and try and approach the person that you think will have the information first before you go down that informal route. The fifth point, once you do go to FOI, the format of what you ask is absolutely crucial. But not only that, the format of what you're asking for, and this comes back to Stuart's point about what the Freedom of Information Act was designed for and what it wasn't designed for. And I think that we forget that information is held in public authorities. We know it's held in email, we know it's held in paper records. We forget other forms of electronic records, definitely permissible within the Freedom of Information Act, to ask for texts, right? And that's something that I do demand, of course. Any records held in paper or electronic form, including texts, may be replaced as wide as possible in terms of looking for those kind of formats. I think Ian's point about the schedule, asking initially for a schedule that you can then follow up, is time saving for everyone concerned in that sense. And allows you to know the things that are there that you're never going to get, right? As well as the things that you may get. I think it's a crucial lesson. Lesson six, keep in contact with your contact. I guess that's the point where the question that you just asked. And as long as you keep in contact with the person, you know the overall limitations of your request. I tried to do that in my work with the health and safety executive and invited my key contact to speak today. I'm assuming that his refusal means that my requests have not been formally vexatious, but probably have caused some vexatious. But it's been crucially important to me to keep in contact with two individuals, actually, in the health and safety executive, to make sure that process is a two-way process. I think that's a really important lesson. Seven, be aware of the limits of the data. Again, we heard from several speakers, data is not necessarily compatible, although we're talking about police forces, across police forces. I am quite cynical about some public authorities now who tend to change the format of the information they publish every few years, and that's quite common actually. A cynical view is that's because it makes it difficult to compare across time, but that doesn't matter. A cynical view doesn't matter. The point is we need to be aware of the data we're using and the limitations of that data, whether it's across geographical areas, whether it's across time. And finally, I think we've had that reiterated in the closing remarks in this session. We have to be in it for the long game. I mean, some of you are PhD students, some of you have short time frames. But I think it's really important in a research project actually to be thinking about formulating freedom of information requests at the development at the beginning of the project rather than as a sweeping exercise, as an afterthought, although that may well come into it. So look, I think that's a very kind of, hopefully I've kind of captured a summary of what we've heard in the first half, and I think I might try and summarise that and substitute it, because I think these are important lessons, some of which passed me by, sorry.
Is that a source of information apart from this? I think that would be a useful summary. The information commissioner does publish awareness levels, which are useful as they explain certain aspects of the Act. And the Freedom of Information campaign for Freedom of Information does have a lot of resources and that's useful. And my organisation, Corporate Watch, are updating the DIY research guide. There will be an updated and extended section on the FLI, the use of it, with practical examples, real life examples. So you can look out for that. It should be out.
Why don't I? I mean, okay, well, if you send that on and it's ready, I'll circulate the links of both the awareness guides and the campaign for free information, if that's something that people would find useful. Okay, that's great. Luke, can I suggest that we come back? Is 5 minutes enough for a comfort break for people to finish off the cake and the conference? Because if we do 5 minutes, it means we've got 40 minutes for a one-to-one workshop. I think, the fact we're so over time is a measure of the level of interest in the subject and the depth of knowledge on this paper.